So, Bill.
Yes.
Can you tell us a little about yourself?
Yes. I am a pastor in just outside of Chicago. And when I tell people I'm from Chicago, I met a man from Germany, and when I was in Germany, and when he heard I was from Chicago, his eyes got real big, and he said, "Chicago?" And like the old gangsters with Al Capone. And it's a little different now. It's a nice place. I am married to my sweetheart, Joanne, and we have three children, and my oldest is married to a fabulous young man, and no grandchildren yet, though, but I want them.
Nice. Have you been in Denmark before?
I've never. This is my first time.
First time in Denmark. And how do you like it so far?
I love it. And the people are very, very nice. But I notice I smile at them, and they look at me like, "Why are you smiling at me?" And so then I think they check their purse and their wallets to make sure I'm not trying to take their money. But the people are very, very friendly. Oh, and last night I had the best steak burger I've ever had in my life.
Han var på grillen burger bar, så ved I det. So, Bill, before you're going to preach for us, I would like to pray for you.
Please.
Og vi gør det simpelthen på dansk, fordi Bill han vil rigtig gerne blive bedre til dansk. Så vi tager simpelthen bønnen på dansk, og så lærer han lige stille af det. So we'll pray. Can I place my hand on you?
Please.
Thank you. Kære himmelske far, tak fordi du har sendt Bill her til Danmark. Tak at du har givet ham en glæde for dit ord og for at forkynde dit evangelium. Far, tak fordi, at vi må have lov til at sidde her, og vi må stole på, at du åbner vores ører, så vi kan høre, hvad du har at sige til os. Læg ordene i Bills mund, så han taler for dig. Ja. Lad det her blive en fantastisk forkyndelse, vi alle sammen kan få noget med hjem fra. Velsign du den her forstund og den her forkyndelse. I dit eget almægtige navn. Amen.
Amen.
Stage is yours.
Thank you. Where I'm from, when the music gets done, and even though it's at a worship and it's good, we thank the band. Can we thank the band? Awesome. So my name is Bill Yonker, and you are wondering right now, what is this slightly chubby but very good-looking man going to say to him? When I said that one time, and there was this girl in the front row, and she said, "He's not very good looking." I tell people, I used to be, so we use pounds in and it's not metric, and so a man my size, but slender, would be about 175 pounds. That's good. So I used to tell people I was 175 pounds of chiseled steel and sex appeal. Now it's spare wheel and oatmeal, but I used to be. So what am I going to say? The best thing I'm going to say is going to happen right at the beginning. And as I travel, though I'm a pastor, I travel around the United States about 20 weekends a year, and I go overseas every once in a while, and I can tell when I got you. I can tell. And then there's sometimes, did you know there's 452 things on the... Don't count. But I don't want to lose you, but I want you to get the best right at the beginning. And it's not my words, they're actually from St. Paul. From Romans 8:37. And let's go ahead and put that up. So our theme is face the fight. But before we even talk about it, I want you to know something. I want you to know that, so in Danish it's the top, and it says, but we are able to overcome all these things and more through his love. Here's actually what my translation says from 8:37. In all these things, we are more than conquerors. A conqueror is a victor. It's a winner. So I am looking right. I'm talking to a bunch of winners. I'm talking to people who are attached to Jesus Christ, who are winners. But listen what it says. Don't miss this. It says that we are able to overcome, but the actual word, the New Testament originally was written in Greek, there's a word that says more. We are more than overcomers. We are more than winners. We are more than conquerors. Now you got to ask yourself, how can you be more than a winner? A winner means you're at the top. How can you be more than a winner? How can you be more than an overcomer? How can you be more than a conqueror? by this, that somebody has already fought the battle for you, took all of the battle scars and battle wounds, but allows you to enjoy the victory. Somebody say amen.
Amen, amen.
The one that did that is Jesus, the Son of God, who battled Satan on Calvary's cross, bled and died, and in his death, he wins. In his resurrection, he says, we are now more than winners, because we don't have to go through what Jesus went through for us. He paid it all, but now we get the results. We get the spoils. We get all that a victor gets, though we didn't have to face the fight like Jesus did. However, we do have to face the fight, because every day Satan is coming after us. I believe it was the great Danish theologian Soren Kierkegaard who said this: the world is not a playground, it's a battleground. Because Satan is waging war against our souls, because he hates us. He wants to take our souls and turn them into a brick in the pavement of hell so that he can walk on us. And it's a good thing we got a victor, because on our own, we'd be lost. I'm not very, very mechanical. I'm not very handy. I'm not a good carpenter. My wife lets me have a hammer and a screwdriver, but she never lets me use them. And it used to bother me, but, you know, then I learned, you know, I don't expect the auto mechanic to baptize his own baby. Why should he expect me to fix my own car? So it was some time ago, we have a minivan, and my wife drives the van, and she came home, and I was home, and she said, honey, there's something wrong with the electric window on the driver's side. You know, you push a button, the window goes down, push a button, the window goes up. And she said, why don't you take a look at it? I said, okay. I have no idea how they work. For all I know, there's little men inside the door. When you push a button, the light goes on, and the foreman says, okay, pull the window up. I don't know how it works. So I thought maybe they were sleepy. So I got in the van, and I tried the window, and I went, oh, yeah. You know, the windows don't work unless the car's on. So I put the key in ignition, I turned it on, and I hit the button. The window was already down. I hit the button, and nothing happened. And I thought, okay, my wife has accurately diagnosed the problem. It's broken. What do you do? Well, if there's little men in there, I thought maybe they needed to be awakened up. So I went, bam, bam, bam. And I reached through the open window and bam, bam, bam. And then I held open the door, and I went, bam, bam, bam. And I hit the button, and the window went up. Thank you. My garage is attached to the back of my house, and so my wife opened the door. She said, it's dinner time. How's it going? I said, fixed it. She said, you did? I said, yeah, and I hit the button, the window went down, hit the button. And she then looked at me, and she said, my hair. No, she didn't, but I wish she would have. She said, it's dinner time. I said, honey, you don't have any gas. She went, oh, I was supposed to get some after I came home from work. I said, baby, you're going to run out of gas. I'm going to run to the gas station real quick and fill it up with gas, because you're not going to remember in the morning. I don't want you running out of gas. She said, well, hurry, dinner is ready. And we have a gas station just two blocks down from our house. So I got in the van, and I drove over there, and I'm filling it up with gasoline. And I'm hoping somebody's going to ask, hey, how do those windows work? I just fixed them. But nobody asked. And as I'm standing there, I see her van is filthy. And at this gas station, there's a car wash attached. Now, the car washes in the States are a little different, where you pull in and you roll the window down, and then you punch in a code. You got to buy the code. You punch in a code. You raise the window, and then you sit in the car when it goes through the car wash. It's kind of fun. And so after I got the gas, I went in and I paid for the gasoline, and then I bought the code that I could punch in. And I drive up, and I don't know how car washes work either. Maybe there's a monster on the bottom that kind of drags you. What do monsters do in the off season? I don't know. So I don't know how they work either. I just know that you punch in the code, and all of a sudden, boom, something grabs your car, and then it pulls you through and all the water and everything. So in the meantime, I keep hitting that button, and it goes down, hit that button going up, because I don't want to go through a car wash if the window's not working. So I get over to the place where the code is, hit the button, the window goes down, it says punch in the code, it says make sure all your windows are up, I did, and then it says hit the green button, and you pull in. So I hit the green button that says start, boom, something grabbed my car, starts pulling me through. And all of a sudden, the water in front of the car starts going. And so I hit the button for the window to go up, and the water's go. Then I hit the button again for the window to go up, and the window was not going up. The water is going, it's coming closer. All of a sudden, I'm like, oh, God, you're playing with me, aren't you? I could just picture him in heaven. Gabriel, Michael, come over here. Yonkers in the car wash with the window down. Let's see what happened. Come on. And so I'm hitting the button. I'm going, God, you're playing. Come on. God. And so then I'm doing what I did before. Bam, bam, bam. Bam, bam, bam. I'm holding the car door open, hitting the inside of the car wash. Bam, 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 bam. Nothing's happened. I hit this button. All of a sudden, I realize it's not God. It's the devil. It's possessed. So I want to perform an exorcism. Out, demons, out, out. All of a sudden, the car comes up, water, blast me. I look over, the inside of the van is getting soaked. And I'm like, ah, because all I can think of is my wife's name is Joanne. What will Joanne say? I go, ah, so I did the only thing I could do. I stood up and I put my belly in the window. And I got a lot of belly. And my head is smashed in the top of the van. But it stopped the water. If you ever wondered if the water is hot in a car wash, wonder no more. Oh my goodness, it was hot. And so I'm screaming, ah! After that water came the suds, the soap. That was okay. Then came the fluffers. I didn't like that. Then came the water again. Ah! And because I thought I'd fixed the window and filled it up with gas, I got the super deluxe job with hot wax. And if you forget you got hot wax, there's a neon sign that goes, hot wax, hot wax. And all of a sudden, after the hot water is hitting my chest, and I it hurts. All of a sudden, I saw, I went, ah, I'm screaming. If you scream in a car wash, can anyone hear you? I think so. All of a sudden, the hot wax hit. Oh, my God, my shirt's the shiniest it's ever been. And then after that comes the hot air to dry. That wasn't too bad. Now, at the outside the car wash are these little people. They don't work for the car wash. They just dry your car, and they hope you give them money tips. And they're little people, little. And I don't know if they speak English or not. They're just, we never talk. They're just little, and they're old. They're about 200 years old. And they dry your car. And I like that, so I always do that, and then I give them each $5. And they do a nice job drying my car. And usually they stand in front, and they don't say anything. They just look at you like, do you want me to dry your car? And I always give what I think is the international sign of yes. I go, yes! And then they dry. I pull in, and I don't run them over. I then stop, and they dry my car. So this time, when the hot air got done, and I would stop screaming, I sat back down in my seat, and I looked, and here are these little people standing going, because they could hear me screaming. And all of a sudden, they remembered their job, and they went, oh, you want me to dry your car? And I said, I was already humiliated. I was already embarrassed. So I said, no! But they kept standing in front of my car, and I'm driving forward, and they're, well, let me drive your car. And I'm going, no! And they didn't seem to get it, so I did what I thought was the international sign of no. I put my arm across my chest, and I went, no! And my elbow hit the button, and the window went up. I tell you that so I can tell you this. I can't make it through a car wash without hurting myself. How am I going to make it through life when I have an enemy who wants to take my soul, my eternal soul, and turn it into a brick in the pavement of hell? How am I going to make it? Because it's a tough world out there. Consider this video clip. I show you that to tell you this. She's doing great all by herself walking down the path until the garbage truck comes up with the garbage men. And if she'd have kept her eyes on the path, she'd have been okay. But the garbage truck with the garbage men, the more antics, the more things they did to distract her, the more she took her eyes off the path and was watching them. And it was then she crashed and burned. You see, there's a big old garbage truck out there. It's called sin. And there's a bunch of garbage men on it called temptations. And what they're going to try to do is to get you to take your eyes off of the path that God has given you to watch them so that you can crash and burn. Now, all of that would be just a terrible, sad story if it wasn't for Jesus. Jesus is real. He's really God, and he really loves us. In fact, he's helplessly, hopelessly, madly in love with us. There's this one account. On the night that Jesus is betrayed, he's in the Garden of Gethsemane praying. 8 of the disciples are at the entrance of the garden. 3, Peter, James, and John were brought in, but they fall asleep. And Jesus is praying. And while he's praying, one of his best friends, one of his disciples, comes leading a band of armed men. And he's about to betray Jesus with the most unbelievably evil way, the international sign of love and affection and friendship, a kiss. Judas had said to the authorities, "The one I kiss, he's the one. Arrest him." And Judas, leading these armed men, come to Jesus. And he embraces them and he kisses them. That was the greeting. "Hail, Rabbi." And they go to arrest Jesus. And then something amazing happens. Jesus stops. And he looks at Judas. And the Gospel of Matthew, only Matthew's Gospel records this. Jesus looks at Judas and he says, "Friend, why have you come?" Now, that may not seem like a very important question at all. It sounds almost, I mean, he's about to be arrested. Jesus knows why Judas was there. He'd even predicted he was going to do it. But he asks this question, "Friend, why have you come?" Was it Jesus had nothing else to say? Oh, come on, Jesus is the word that became flesh. Every word that Jesus says is important. And notice how he addresses Judas. "Friend." Now, you know as well as I know, it's not just what you say, but how you say it You know, if somebody does something stupid, you might say, oh, he's brilliant. You don't really mean that they're smart. You're actually saying the opposite. Well, how did Jesus say this word? How do you think he said it? Did he say it in a way of mockery and scorn? Friend, why have you come? That's not the way of Jesus. Was it one of self-pity? Friend, why have you come? For this reason, Jesus was born. Jesus left the heavens, was born of the Virgin on that first Christmas night so that he could grow up and die for us. It was for this reason he was born. Why is he saying? It's not self-pity. It is true compassion. Oftentimes, you'll hear in the New Testament that Jesus had compassion on people. One time he saw the people and they were like, he had compassion on them because they were sheep, like sheep without a shepherd. Or in the story of the prodigal son, where the son leaves and comes back, and it says, while he was yet a long way off, the father saw him, and we know the father represents God, the father, and that the son represents us, and it says, and the father had compassion on him. Now that emotion, compassion, the actual Greek word is spalagna. Say that. Spalagna. And it literally means from the gut, from the bowels, from the pit of your being. When it says Jesus had compassion, it wasn't just a momentary feeling of pity, like, oh, poor thing. That's not what it was. It was from the gut, from the depths of his bowels. He had compassion. And I believe when he said to Judas, friend, it was one last ditch effort to let even his betrayer know that Jesus loved him. That Jesus indeed was going to die, but he was going to die for Judas too. Now sadly, Judas didn't get the message. He didn't hear it. But it amazes me. The greatest act of betrayal in the history of human beings was done with a kiss to the Son of the Living God. And Jesus says, friend, why do I say that? I tell you that to tell you this. If Judas was Jesus' friend, so are you. And so are you. And so are all of you, even the likes of me. Jesus calls us friend. And he not only calls us friend, he takes away the barrier between us and him and us and our Heavenly Father. The barrier, our sin that we have indulged in, because we've been watching the garbage truck. We've been watching the garbage men. And we have fallen short of God's glory, and there's been times we've crashed and burned. But he calls us friend by dying for us, taking away our sins, rising from the grave. And he says, yeah, there is a battle. There is a fight. Face the fight. Life isn't all pudding and jello, soft and sweet and easy to go down and digest. For there is an enemy. There's an old Latin phrase that says this, si vis pacem para bellum. And it means, if you want peace, prepare for war. And that doesn't mean a militaristic sense of being. It means understanding that we have Jesus. Luther said this, if it's between us and the devil, we're done for. But if it's between the devil and us wrapped in Jesus, the devil doesn't stand a chance. Because Jesus won. And we are attached to that Jesus in our faith. We are baptized into that. And we are now more than winners. Consider this video clip. didn't just call us friend. He bled and died to take away our sin, to take away any boundaries we would have. He fought the fight for us. He didn't just jump up on the cross and say, let's do this. And the physical pain, horrific, awful. But there was more. He took our sins on himself. I hate feeling guilty. I can't imagine carrying my guilt and someone else's, let alone everyone else's in the history of the world. But he did that. Jesus tells this incredible parable about a shepherd that has 100 sheep, and one of them strays, and 99 are left, and he leaves the shepherd then leaves the 99 with another shepherd. There's always two shepherds, and he goes after the one. And Jesus tells that parable to let us know that even if we're the one, even if it's just us, I believe this with all my heart, even if you were the only person in the history of the world that ever sinned, Jesus would have still left the heavenly realms, would have been born of the Virgin Mary, would have grown up and would have died just for you. Because you matter that much. For God so loved the world. But God so loves you. Last thing that'll be done this afternoon till tonight. A lot of years ago, I ran across this story, and it changed my life, changed my ministry. And because it's so important, I always give credit to the author of the story. His name's Richard Pindell. I think he's passed away. But the story is about a young man and his father who had a terrible fight. And the father said what dads sometimes say, as long as you live under my roof, you'll do as I say. And the son said, fine, I won't live under your roof. And he left. And he was gone for a number of months. And during that time, he ran out of money, but he also ran out of anger, and he missed his parents. So finally he decided he should go home and try to work things out. He didn't have money for a plane, though he was on the other side of the country in the States. But he hadn't had enough money for a train ticket. So he got to the train depot, and he was waiting for the train to leave, and he was sitting there, and all of a sudden it dawned on him that maybe his parents didn't want him to come home. And this is back in the days before cell phones. And so for you young people, we used to have phones that were attached to a wall. I know it sounds weird. And they were too big to carry in your pocket. They were like this. And so sometimes there were whole booths, and they were glass so people could see you talking on them. That's still weird to me. But he started thinking, maybe they don't want me to come home. So he went to, it's called a payphone. He went to the payphone. And in the States, you pick up the handset, and you could dial zero, and you'd get the operator, and you could make what's called a collect call. And then the operator would talk to the people on the other end of where you want to call and ask if they would pay for the charges. So the boy made a collect call. His mother answered the phone. She said, of course, we'll pay for the charges. And she said, are you okay? He says, I'm fine, Mom. She said, I've been so worried. I'm glad to hear your voice. He said, Mom, I want to come home. She said, oh, thank God. Please come home. And he goes, really? She goes, oh, I've missed you so terribly. Excuse me. I've missed you so terribly. Please come home. And he says, well, what about Dad? Does Dad want me to come home? And she kind of went quiet. And he said, Mom? And she said, well, I don't know. He said, what do you mean you don't know? Does he say he misses me? She said, honey, your father hardly ever talks anymore. Ever since that night when you left, he's a different man. You know, he was always such a happy-go-lucky fella. He'd give the shirt off his back. He was handshaking and hugging and patting people on the back. He doesn't do any of that anymore. He gets up in the morning. He barely says two words. And you know how close your father and I have always been. We've always talked. He barely says two words to me. He goes to work. He comes home. He sits in front of the TV. And then he goes to bed, and on the weekends he just goes out in the garage to his workshop and he sits there. He doesn't make anything, he just sits there. He's been doing that ever since, so I don't know. And he said, well, Mom, maybe he doesn't want me to come home. She said, I'm sure he does. He said, can you guarantee? She said, no, because he won't talk. He said, Mom, I don't want to come home if he doesn't want me home. He said, Mom, the train's going to leave. I got to know. Tell me, should I come home? She said, yes, please come home. And he said, but do you think Dad wants me? She said, I don't know. And he said, Mom, I got to get on the train if I'm going to, Mom, you know how the train goes across the back of your and Dad's property? Remember, there's that old dead apple tree out there. Dad and I were going to take it down this summer. You tell Dad that I'm on the train. And if he wants me to come home, tell him to hang a white handkerchief, a white cloth, from one of the branches of that tree. If I see the white handkerchief, I'll know I can come home. Mom, I got to go. I love you. And he hung up the phone and he jumped on the train. He didn't have enough money for a sleeper car, so he sat in coach. He was kind of crowded in there, but he found a seat right by the window. And as he sat down, he didn't make eye contact with anybody. He just was waiting for the train to start when he felt a presence next to him. And he looked, and there was an older gentleman that was sitting next to him. And the young man looked up at him, and the older gentleman smiled and kind of nodded. And the boy smiled but quickly turned away as if to say, leave me alone. For many hours, the train traveled. Finally, the boy felt a nudge at his elbow, and he looked into the kind eyes of the man sitting next to him. And the man said, son, I don't want to get in your business, but we've been riding together a lot of hours, and you keep having these heavy sighs, and I can hear you groaning deep within your heart, and I can tell something's bothering you, and if you don't want to talk about it, I'll respect that. But I've been told I'm a good listener, and I think sometimes talking about it helps. And the young man looked up into the kind eyes of that older gentleman. And though he was a private boy, the story started to tumble out. And he told about how he had gotten in this fight with his father and how he'd left home, how he traveled far away, all that he did during the months he was gone, and how he now wanted to go back home. And as the boy was finishing the story, he looked out the window and he said, pretty soon the train's going to make a turn, a bend. And once the train clears that bend, my parents' property is going to be on the right-hand side, the starboard side of the train. And half a mile down, there's going to be that apple tree. And just as he was telling about that, he could notice that there were other people, some of them who had pretended to be reading, some were working crossword puzzles, some were taking a nap, some were playing cards. But he could tell they were all listening, but he didn't care. He'd never see them again. As the train was making its turn, all of a sudden a great well of emotion welled up in the boy. Tears sprang to his eyes. And as he felt the train make the turn, he buried his face in his hands, and he bent over and put his forehead by his knees. He could feel the train complete the turn. He literally could feel, without looking, the other passengers straining to stare out the window on his side because they'd all been listening. And he was hoping he'd hear a, yay, there it is, or hooray, you gotta look. But as the train kept going, all of a sudden, he heard everyone at the same time gasp. And he knew it was bad news. And so he started to cry again harder. It was then he felt a hand on his shoulder. And the older gentleman whispered to him, sit up, boy. It's time you face your future. Sit up, boy. It's time to be a man. And the young man allowed the older man to pull him up. And then the older man gently pushed the boy's hands away And as he wiped his eyes with the back of his hands, he looked out the window just as they were passing that old dead apple tree. And the boy saw there was not a white cloth hanging from that apple tree. There were 100 white cloths hanging from all of the branches of that apple tree. And the message couldn't have been any clearer. The father was saying, I want you home. I don't want to live my life, not in your presence, not in your family. Please come home. Please be with me. Our Heavenly Father didn't hang a white cloth on an apple tree. He hung his son, the Savior Jesus, on a tree called cross. And the message can't be any clearer. I want you to be with me. Satan, he wants to take your soul and turn it into a brick in the pavement of hell. And you on your own, you can't face that fight by yourself. I can't even make it through a car wash on my own. But we don't have to. Because we have Jesus. Over the next couple of days, this Jesus, who has fought for us, who now gives us the ability to get into the fight, even though we're already more than conquerors, will be with us. And my prayer is that you are drawn ever closer to him. Not so that you're a better little boy or girl, but so that you would know that you individually, you personally, you particularly, are the beloved of the one called Jesus. Somebody say amen. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus Christ, you've come mightily to this place, and you've done it many times. This weekend, oh Holy Spirit, come to those who know you well. Draw them ever closer. To those who had known you well but maybe have fallen away or slid backwards, Lord, draw them close again. And if there are any that don't know you, may you be revealed to them so that they would rejoice in knowing of your love, of your grace, of your winning, and of their own victory forevermore. All this we pray in your name, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Thank you for listening to me this afternoon.